Oh, yeah. That's just what we need to get into a good rankings discussion. A fresh pop.
Fresh pop.
All right. Well, we had our fun discussing a little Davante Adams, a little Michael Thomas, kind of, you know, what makes them tick and what makes them good at their position and the reasons why and you know, kind of how we all feel about them and the system and their abilities and the quarterback around them and all that good stuff. But let's get into the actual ranking. And the question at hand here was basically, had Davante Adams and Michael Thomas supplanted, you know, possible mainstays of Julio Jones and AJ Green in kind of the hierarchy of dynasty rankings here.
Yeah.
And that's what we're here to figure out right now. Right. So let's start right at number five.
Because we can all agree that the top four are in any order you want to put them in, but it's Nuke, it's Odell, it's AB, and it's Mike Evans. That's our consensus top four.
That's what we're going
to
start.
Not in that order, but any order we wanted to personally argue that,
right.
that we're all
semantics,
agreeing.
Yes. However you want
to
go about it.
We're going to fast forward to top four. Those right. are the big four. Right. We're going to start at five.
Right.
For this discussion.
All right. So it's been basically Amari Cooper for a while. I would say that I have a hard time moving him out of that five spot, but maybe that's just because of a mental block. Can somebody convince me otherwise?
To move Amari out?
To move Amari out and maybe Michael Thomas or Davante Adams in there?
Well, I think for a lot of people, it was either in that spot, it's either Julio Jones or Amari Cooper, and potentially if your flavor is A.J. Green. There's a lot of A.J. Green backers just talking about how nasty he was or is. As far as talking about, can I talk you into backing up Amari Cooper? Before we start trying to back him up, let's understand why he got there to begin with. The kid's 23 years old.
Right.
You know, so sure, the
youngest player on this whole list of top 10 that we're
not
even, talk
yeah,
about.
Yeah. And you mentioned like Michael Thomas and Odell Beckham Jr. has the 90 catches 2 years in a row to start a season. But before Michael Thomas jumped in that conversation, Amari Cooper has done more at an earlier age.
His first 2 years than anybody else.
At his age, because he came in so – he's 23. There's rookies that are older than him. He's been in the league 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
So that let's just start there with Amari Cooper.
I feel like most rookies are older than
– I know. This yeah. year's rookies are still older than Amari Cooper. So that's where I'm at on Amari Cooper is what he's done before is he should have still – in most cases, that stuff's – he's still in college. So,
right.
You know? I don't know if his parents put him ahead in a grade or how this happened, but Mark Cooper's still young as hell.
Right, and we all, whether you like it or not, in some way, shape, or form, everyone falls a little bit victim of sort of the quote-unquote recency bias. You know, the Raiders were supposed to be really good this year. You were hoping for the breakout. It's the coveted third year.
No doubt. No doubt.
So, you know, it's easy to get really down on Amari Cooper with, you know, you have all the aforementioned things that we just talked about.
So
you
much
know,
hate on Derek Carr going
yeah,
around.
Right. You had Derek Carr who was, you know, in.
And to parallel what you just said there, it's so easy to make your top 10 the top 10 scores this year.
Right.
It's exactly. Right. You got the recency negative and you got the recency positive. It's
right.
so easy to look at the top 10 scores and be like, yep, that's how it happened. That's what it's going to be.
Absolutely.
And that's not how it works.
There's dysfunction in the Raiders right now. My biggest thing that I said a while ago from just watching this squad play was that they aren't ready to be a team yet.
Yep.
They're not a team. They're not glued together, and you can make fun of me or say whatever you want, but I've heard, after I said this to Big Co, I've heard multiple other people say, like,
dude,
media people say
you
this.
You said it 3 hours before we were discussing. We got a team where we got Crabtree and Amari Cooper. We were discussing which one, if any, or both, if we were going to plug in our lineups. We plugged them both in, and you were like, I don't want to plug them both in. Because
this is early season.
This was mid-season, and you were like, I don't want to be plugging both of these cats in right now because something's wrong with the Raiders. They don't play like a team. And sure enough, that afternoon, I'm watching the game. They looked horrible. Both of those players are holding down our lineup that week. And then the commentator's like, well, these guys aren't out here playing like a team. And I'm like, holy cow, Casey told me that this morning. And that's exactly how it broke down.
It's evident. There's some sort of disconnect somewhere along the line. I don't know where it is, what it is, how it's going, you know. but they're just, they haven't congealed yet. They haven't homogenized, however you want to put all that together. Like, it's just, it's not working out. David Carr had a broken back at some point, or a back injury at some point, missed one game. The offensive line hasn't been as good as it was, and the run game has been not nearly as good as it was. They got a, their offensive coordinator shouldn't be their offensive coordinator, I don't think. Mm-mm. I never liked the way the offense functioned. They were running a lot of like heavy package with like six linemen last year. You're not seeing any of that this year.
No doubt.
It's just, there's a whole bunch of weird stuff going on over there, and maybe they'll get it figured out. And like you said, the thing with Amari Cooper is he's still really young. So knock me off of Amari Cooper at five, because I'm okay. I could go either way.
Let's ponder this thing that happened to the Raiders this year, because like you said, they've changed up some things and it's obviously not working. And coming into the year, all we could hear was Lynch and that great offensive line. And now it's going to open up for the passing game because they got Lynch. This past Sunday night in the Week 15 game, the Raiders had the Cowboys on Sunday night. And Tony Romo said that their power run game and their passing offense does not complement each other. They're either running power with Marshawn Lynch or they're trying to spread it out with a passing game, and those things don't overlap, which is the complete opposite of what happens in New Orleans with Peyton's X's and O's. So
there's no mystery on the defense.
Exactly. So something's happened. The Raiders, they didn't hit the mark this year with coordinator, quarterback, play calling, injuries, what have you. It's not happening on the field. Their running game is their running game, and their passing game is their passing game, and those two things aren't running in the same direction and riding down the same street. They don't ride in the same car together. And that's what Tom...
It's broken.
It is. It's broken. And that's what Tony Romo told me on Sunday night, and it was brilliant breakdown by Tony, and that goes right into what you were saying. And so the Raiders just fell off the cliff this year.
No guessing to what they're doing out there. They're showing you, and that's it.
They're in the Super Bowl conversation before the season starts, and now they're, this great little division they're in is they're pulling up the rear.
All right.
So to the question, knock you off Amari. Let me see if I can knock you off Amari, because I love Amari Cooper. I'm a huge proponent of Amari Cooper. I got plenty of stock in Amari Cooper.
Sure,
love the guy. But I think right now, I think I'd trade Amari Cooper to get Michael Thomas. Like, for everything you guys just said about the Raiders and the direction they're going, that's recency bias at its best. Michael Crabtree is there. There's not really a Michael Crabtree, maybe like in the Saintsville. I guess Kamara is a pretty big roadblock to production from anyone else's standpoint, but Michael Thomas is the dude right there.
But I don't mean to cut you off, but I don't think there's many people, I don't think you're going to get Michael Thomas for Amari Cooper right now from anybody.
Right. So then how could we not put him above that guy, right?
True. Yeah. Because at the end of the day, Amari Cooper is the youngest player on this list, and he has done some things in his early part of his career, but at the end of the day, it comes down to fantasy points.
Right.
And right now, he ain't scoring them, and Michael Thomas is.
He's crushing it. And
Michael Thomas, as well as Devontae Adams.
And Michael Thomas is definitely going to have, well, I say definitely, but most likely he's going to have Drew Brees for another year, possibly I would say better than 50-50 shot he's got him for 2 years.
Well, like you said, there's a really good chance that you're going to get one. Two's kind of iffy. You never know.
My gut says two. I'm gonna go two. Well, possibly even more. This dude
you can take one and take it to the bank and figure it out from there. And
right.
Like you said,
yes,
if you can get two, you'll definitely you personally, Jay Wayne, is absolutely taking that to the bank, and you'll deal with it later, which is completely fair.
Sure.
I mean, I would like to say that Amari Cooper next year could be Michael Thomas in the same vein.
Yep.
It's true.
You know,
it's true.
And we're just,
knocking him down one spot.
Right, I'm not arguing with you. I'm just saying, like, the general public consensus is like, well, Amari's not any good. He's, you know, maybe we missed the mark on this guy. And, you know, it's just,
oh, no way.
Well, a lot of people are just, well, oh, this is going to be the third year. When is it still waiting for Amari Cooper to break out? All those kind of things.
Okay. So I guarantee you, if you go look it up, I did some of this with Stephon Diggs versus Antonio Brown in the preseason. But I guarantee you that Amari Cooper has 100 more catches than Antonio Brown did at this point in his career.
Oh, I'm sure.
So anybody, I'm not going to repeat myself. This dude is 23. So if you want to talk about a third year breakout that didn't happen, this man broke out as a freshman in the NFL. He broke out as a sophomore in the NFL, and his whole team collapsed on him this year. So I don't want to hear that. And people that are saying that, they just need to get out of your 2 week window.
So Michael Thomas turns 25. In April, and Amari Cooper turns 24 in June. So, you know, it's somewhere, not enough somewhere for me around to sway. A yeah. year, but yeah, no.
That's nothing to sway me. If you want to make an argument for Amari Cooper, I think maybe his ceiling is a little higher. Like, Michael Thomas doesn't have a single game over 30 points this year PPR.
Right.
But he doesn't have, he only has one game that was bad. He had two games under 10 points, but the one of those was 9.5. So I'll take that as my second
but
worst
the after,
week of the year.
The after breeze stuff is what really concerns me. And like, I get playing the business decision of saying I'm going to take these targets
now
and
points.
Take these now points, and it's real easy to live in the now. But eventually, Breeze isn't going to be around, and just like we discussed previous to this, like every great receiver, you know, pretty much on here with the exception of DeAndre Hopkins, who, you know, who people left for dead and was like, oh, this guy wasn't any good
exactly.
anyway.
That's
you
exactly
know?
How it happened.
And
yeah.
now all of a sudden you got Deshaun Watson over there. And to me,
oh
you
God.
Know, he's my consensus number one. Just because the ceiling of DeAndre Hopkins is what you got, and then you got the floor of Savage
right.
with Tom Savage and T.J. Yates, which has still been really awesome.
Balling.
Yeah.
And you've seen him play with Hoyer and all those other guys, blah, 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 blah. I digress.
Well,
blah, blah, blah.
If Amari Cooper starts the year next year with three games of 6 for 100 and a touch, he's his value swing is going to be so incredible. So it's still there. And like the now points for Michael Thomas, for me, it does it means a lot. And
yeah,
it's a if on Amari Cooper, but
so what are you doing? Five? You going Michael Thomas? You going Amari Cooper there?
Or Julio Jones? I know you're a big Julio Jones guy.
I am. Julio Jones.
I am. But let's transition that right into Julio Jones. I'm gonna put Michael Thomas at five.
Okay.
Because but everything we talked about in the Michael Thomas segment before. I think he's got staying power past Drew Brees. The next year or two the second year is a huge bonus. Anything past that is just like victory laps. If I can get 2 years, if I 1 year, I'll take the now points. 2 years would be a huge bonus with Drew Brees. Michael Thomas is here to stay, and when Drew Brees leaves, I'll have to deal with that.
Well,
later.
Right. And what you're hoping for is that maybe you get a year or two of like, you know, wide receiver 25 to 18, somewhere around in there. Or
the next big guy comes around?
Well, before the next quarterback right. comes around from Michael Thomas, hopefully you get like a year or two of bridge.
Well,
you
had to deal with that for DeAndre Hopkins. You had to deal with him having
right.
the quarterback turnover that the Texans have gone through has costed head coach after head coach after head coach, you know, jobs.
So that's what you're hoping for.
Yeah. So,
But it could never come.
And
Sean Payton could be gone.
No doubt. But right now,
so what are you doing?
Two straight years in the top 10 in points, and that was his first 2 years. So you got to assume he gets better. The same conversation we had about Amari Cooper last year.
I think,
except for his quarterback's not 39 years old.
Right. Right.
So that's what it comes down to.
I think I'm with you guys. I think I want Michael Thomas at five.
Okay, that's nice. That's very surprised that we all three agree to that same number. So that's
we really got somewhere here.
A top five.
Well, I mean, this is all speculative. Way too early.
Soon, yeah.
You never know what the hell is about to happen
well,
and unfold.
Right.
And
Drew Brees isn't even on deck for next year.
Where other receivers
so,
go yes. in other places.
But
and
Michael
all that.
Thomas at five is a good one for tonight. We feel it's good.
All right, so we started this whole thing off. I think that was good. A good point to bring up. So we have Michael Thomas at five. We basically were kind of putting Davante Adams and Michael Thomas above above Julio and AJ Green, and we're starting right at five, and already Michael Thomas is boom right there.
Boom.
And you know, as far as me watching the film and all that stuff, like I saw from Davante Adams, I liked more from a film perspective, route running kind of perspective, but I liked the schematics and what was going on with Michael Thomas a whole lot better, and it just seems like pretty safe, at least for a year, maybe two.
Yep.
So, you know, that's kind of
safe and consistent.
That's kind of what swayed my decision. I might like Davante Adams' abilities a little more, but I like Michael Thomas's situation, and I like his abilities enough to, you know, throw him right there. And again, Devontae's 4 years in the league. Michael Thomas is 2 years in the league. Mm-hmm. And so
true.
All right, so let's keep it moving. So we brought Julio into the end of this thing. We got Devontae still on the hook.
Looming.
And
AJ Green. Amari
and
Cooper.
So now we bumped Amari
somewhere.
Out of the five.
Yep.
Right.
What do we got at six here?
Let me get Amari Cooper.
He's taking Amari in the true dynasty building aspect, the definition of the word. He's taking the 23-year-old A-plus prospect that now has some
I don't
numbers.
Like that his quarterback wears eyeliner, but whatever.
Sure, can't like that. That's a tough one to like. That's a tough like.
And he won't even own it. Just own it. There's definitely eyeliner on those eyes. You got the good stuff. It doesn't run.
It doesn't
You're out
run.
There crying mascara.
These colors
running,
don't but... run, Bo.
All right. So
who you got to
find?
Jay Wayne
wants to go
there.
Six for Amari Cooper.
You want to go Julio, don't you?
I sure do. I sure do want to go Julio. How did you know?
I don't know. You own him all those dynasty leagues that you have him in.
Basically on the same, I can pretty much sum it up for you. Basically on the same reason why we just took Michael Thomas at 5 is why Bitco wants to take Julio
True.
Jones at 6, because you've seen him put up 40s and 50s and you've seen him be so good for so long. And
Matt
if you
Ryan's
wanted to
not
just,
going anywhere. He's not going anywhere.
If you wanted to just put pure athleticism on a receiver with size and all and measure all those immeasurable or measurable fucking freaking effing...
Yeah, he's up at the top. You
right.
might maybe number one on this list.
Absolutely. I mean, the dude's an absolute horse. Like,
yeah,
you know, just needs
he's a physical freak.
His quarterback and just needs to be schemed better. And then the touchdowns, just, the touch, like it's ridiculous the
yeah,
amount
the
of
red
the red zone,
targets
are absolutely out of control with in a bad way with Julio Jones. And
this is true.
You mentioned about Sark here.
Well, they got the first time offensive coordinator ever in the NFL with Sarkisian. He comes in. He's obviously had some trials and tribulations in the last couple years personally. I didn't like it to begin with.
He wouldn't make it on this show. Too much drinking.
No way. Out of here. Yeah,
be right back on the wagon or off the wagon, whichever it is.
Whichever one's bad.
The bad direction of that on and off the wagon, he's not going to be in the good spot in that wagon if he's hanging out in this control room.
Dojo.
Well done.
We need a Stone Cold Steve Austin like.
Badab, badab, badab.
Oh my God, can I get the rattlesnake? It's 316. Yo, I just looked it up. Julio Jones has 4 red zone receptions.
Receptions.
Yeah.
Yeah.
17 targets.
So not good. The thing is, like, Julio's not going anywhere. Obviously, his injuries, he's always limping around on the in the game. It drives me nuts, but he's an absolute monster.
Screw foot.
This quarterback situation is as solid as almost anybody's, but not the two wide receivers we were talking about earlier.
Solid, not great.
But solid, very solid, not great, great. But the offense just went through a huge transition from last year to this year. The down
from
like,
boy genius to
from boy genius to alcoholic man is trying to get his life together, which is really what happened. It's a very accurate statement on my part. But what really happened was they got shamed in the Super Bowl. You know what I mean? Like, how many times you see a Super Bowl winner loser not even make the playoffs next year because losing
hey, they're
to
right
the,
in the hunt, losing they're right there,
I know,
NFC
I know, follow me.
South is
losing,
guys,
and,
guys,
losing,
guys,
guys.
Way
losing
too much
co-centric
analysis here.
Losing in the Super Bowl is not cool. Exactly. This narrative street, you want to call it what you want. There's not a whole lot of metrics behind that other than 28-3.
Right.
You know, they had them, and then they didn't have them.
We let them off the hook.
They let them off the hook, and now the Falcons have to go through the worst offseason in memory.
And bounce back better than most teams do,
exactly.
And had a really solid stretch there. I don't think they're going to really make any noise.
I don't think it would surprise anybody if Julio Jones came out next year and was absolutely averaging 28 points a game. It's not going to surprise you when he tears it up again. He went for a 50-burger this year again. You know, he's got the most 250-yard receiving games in the history of the league. When he goes off, he goes off.
Yeah.
And so I'm sticking with Julio Jones near the top here just because it's very safe pick minus a screw foot.
If I'm on the clock, I'm going Amari Julio.
Okay,
I think that's where I'm at. So I'd go Amari 6, Julio 7. Who do you guys have at 7 then?
I'll take Julio there at 7.
Okay, so we're pretty much on the same page, Big Co.
You gonna go Amari or you gonna go AJ?
This is where I'm sliding in Davante Adams right here at 7.
Ooh, just slipping him in.
I had to slide him in. He's done a lot for me this year.
So sell Davante over Julio for me real quick. Give me that because I could
well,
be swayed.
No, Davante over Amari.
Oh, Amari, right.
Davante
right.
over Amari, and okay. At this point, Davante and AJ Green, because I just put Davante Adams in.
Right. Sorry, Davante over Amari. Sell that to me there.
Well,
I guess it's not that hard.
Well, his
it's not that hard.
His contract is up. We're completely in the dark about whether or not he's going to be playing with Aaron Rodgers.
But we do know he can play without him.
And he's just been on fire. Whether it's Aaron Rodgers throwing in the ball or not. And the stink that is in Oakland Raider territory right now. That boy's about to move to Las Vegas. They don't know what's going on. The quarterback wears eyeliner. I mean,
and then you got the Green Bay, you got the Green Bay side of things where Devontae it's a pretty steady ship. You got Jordy, who either could be cut or restructured,
and he's
at the end of his career.
Right.
Randall Cobb probably is going to be the one that gets the axe here if anybody's getting the axe.
Right.
They probably should bring Devontae Adams back with the development and Aaron Rodgers and all that, blah, blah, blah. And then get Ty Montgomery, who fills in Randall Cobb's position without any problem.
And maybe Randall Cobb stays because with Randall Cobb there, Devontae's still been a beast. He's been a wide receiver with Randall Cobb.
The problem is with that is then they're paying so much money to three wide receivers.
Yeah. Well, so they can sit, they'll eat $2.3 million in dead cat money if they cut Jordy, and they'll eat 3-point-something million if they cut Randall.
I don't think Aaron Rodgers will let them cut Jordy.
I don't either.
I think there's a restructure happening in that point.
But right now.
Right. But I could easily see Randall Cobb getting the axe in this situation.
His deal's not that big. No, it's $3 million.
Right,
it's
but I mean,
no, no, they have to pay him 10 if they want to keep him,
okay,
but they'll,
yeah,
eat,
yeah, yeah.
Three,
they'll eat
plus three if they cut him.
Yeah, 10 million. That's what Allen.
They'd have to restructure. There's no way Randall Cobb stays around
Allison
for $10 million next year.
You got Geronimo Allison for real cheap. You got Ty Montgomery for real cheap for a little while. So you could pay Devontae and then, you know, eat a little bit on the front end and, you know, be able to pay Devontae and then figure it out from there, which, you know, who knows what they'll really do. But I just wanted to bring light to that situation. I don't think we talked about that when we were talking about Devontae Adams.
You know what? Maybe I could put Devontae up there over Amari, because I my gut feeling here after this discussion and all this, we've been trying to figure this out all night. He's got to be back in Green Bay, right?
He's got to be.
I don't know. I really don't know. I'm 50-50 on this thing.
Is that why you're going to go Amari over Devontae?
I can't get over the, like, again, like, yeah. I'm just stuck
the
on the
price
fact
of
the,
Devontae
of the,
Adams at this point.
No, just the prospect of Amari Cooper, man.
Yeah.
Like, I just
it's not over. It's not
I, right.
It's not,
and
yeah.
I cannot stand when people just
bury him.
Bury guys for, like, it's just, it hasn't all been Amari's fault.
There's been
all sorts of things in that equation.
It just happened just like this. 2 years ago, DeAndre Hopkins was the third or fourth wide receiver in Dynasty, and you couldn't argue with it any deep. You couldn't back him up past four, because I remember he was the fourth, and it was Allen Robinson at five. That was 2 years ago, and that was how it was, the top five in every Dynasty League draft. Started 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and it was Nuke Hopkins and Allen Robinson in that fourth and fifth spot. And last year happened, and Hopkins just couldn't get a quarterback to throw him the ball. And next thing you know, Hopkins is at the end of the first round, top of the second round, and now the Texans have him going. The ball's going to him again. And then we obviously got the awesome quarterbacks, you know, just a couple of weeks there, just blowing people out of the water. And then Hopkins is back here again. That's what I was saying about if Amari comes out with a couple of weeks.
We've seen a
couple
the
of weeks out of
early
Amari, he's
Super
right
Bowl
back in.
Prediction kind of people. And
yep.
Then the Raiders bounce back next year and all of a sudden are
all is
you
good
know,
again.
Yep. Really, really just strong. Like, and, you know, Crabtree is at least on the opposite end of the spectrum of career wise anyway. And, you know, I feel like that holds back Amari a little bit.
Yeah, well, Crabtree's 30 years old, like you said. He had his own problems to deal with at the beginning of his career. But you and I argued all preseason. We had a bet about whether Michael Crabtree or Amari Cooper would have the most fantasy points this year. Obviously, Crabtree won that this year, but next year it could be the flip
right.
the script. It could be the exact Amari could crush next year, and Crabtree could be a WR2.
I really want to, because of last year and this year, and I like to see the consistency and all that stuff. I really want to put Devontae Adams right under Michael Thomas in this discussion here, but I'm having a hard time of getting off Amari Cooper. Maybe that's just me being stubborn, and maybe as this thing, you know, goes down the line here, maybe I'll get over it a little bit. But for right now, like I'm sticking to my guns here, and hanging out with Amari Cooper.
Well, just to recap where we've been up to this point, we all kind of settled at Michael Thomas at the number 5 overall dynasty wide receiver. If you ask me personally, I would go Amari Cooper at 6,
which I was in agreement with.
Right, Julio Jones at 7, and Devontae Adams at 8. Big Co, you got a little bit of a shifted order there.
Right, I went Julio at 6, Devontae Adams at 7, Amari at 8.
And Casey, you got Devontae there at 8 then?
I think I'm going to go Keenan Allen at 8.
Yeah.
I think I'm going to go Keenan Allen 8, Amari or
Devontae.
Devontae at 9, and then AJ Green at 10. I think that's where I'm at.
Well, I'm ready to get into a Keenan discussion. I think that's where we're about to lead to here. Get in some Keenan Allen.
I don't think we get too much farther down the list before AJ Green has to jump up. So
that's true. So Keenan Allen, AJ Green, you got a preference there, Big Co?
Well, obviously, forever I would have gone AJ Green, but Keenan Allen strings together of 15 games of health here and top 10 wide receiver numbers, and it's just the Bengals are doing what Bengals do and implode and
bungling.
And Andy Dalton looks horrible right now, and it's easy to like what Keenan Allen's putting out there right now. It's really easy to like, and he's 4 years younger. And of course, we went through two seasons in a row where he's hurt. Last year it was 1 week, so that right. just really stung. And Keenan Allen, it tested the truthers, and this year
paid off for him.
It's paying off
dividends,
now. Paying off now big time. So I don't mind. I don't mind Keenan Allen being in front of AJ Green. I can't argue with you.
Yeah, well. I mean, maybe we should have led the show with Keenan Allen, Devontae Adams, and Michael Thomas breakdown here.
Yeah.
Because I just jumped Keenan
ship.
Allen in front of Devontae Adams. And I guess it's just, I don't know, just sheer volume. And Phil, I'm sure, is going to hang around over there. The Chargers are getting better. You had a couple of missteps in the beginning of the season, but they could easily be in control of this division right now and be 3 or 4 games ahead of where they are.
Yeah, that loss they just took to the Chiefs. I didn't see that coming, but that really kind of put a dampen on that the whole division run and possibly
right.
their playoff run. They got some work to do.
There's a chance that Tyrell Williams is out of there next year. He's a restricted free agent. You got Mike Williams coming in, but we're nobody's sure exactly what that's going to bear. And Phil Rivers just chucks
loves
it,
Keenan.
Just bludgeons Keenan with targets. And
he does.
Obviously the knock on Keenan's been the health and all that stuff, but if Keenan stays healthy, I mean, what he does on the field is fantastic. We did a whole long thing about Devontae Adams' route running ability. Well, Keenan Allen's right there with him, man.
Whole nother level.
It's so good.
It's even better.
And him and Phil are on the same page, and they're just that's just who he's looking for. That's his guy. Like he moves the chains with him. He scores touchdowns with him. He bludgeons him when he's unconscious. Just keeps hammering this guy. It's a borderline. He could be hit with
hitting
a rape charge.
He's hitting him in his sleep. Yeah,
it's borderline rapey.
Yeah, yeah.
So,
but
I mean,
I like
I guess,
it. This is, yeah.
I guess that's where I'm leaving. I really want to put Devontae. Like, again, I want to put Devontae Adams a little higher on this. Totem pole here, but I think I'm going Keenan and Devontae, and then AJ Green.
Is it just because that Devontae might not be a Packer next year? Or you just
no,
gotta
I don't
take straight up Keenan.
I think I'm just taking straight up Keenan and Phil, and the Packers are gonna spread it around, and I don't think Jordy's going anywhere for at least a year. I think they'll restructure like we talked about.
Yeah,
and I think there's just other targets to go around, and Aaron Rodgers just doesn't get locked on one guy. I mean, Phil will again. Just keep pumping it to Keenan, and I'm loving what I'm seeing from Keenan Allen. It's just been great, and every time that there's been stretches of games where Keenan's played, it's been great.
Every time.
Yeah, and
Keenan,
he's on a hot stretch right now.
They've been scorching hot. They did go into the Kansas City in late November, early mid-December in Kansas City.
Tough
it's always
place
tough.
To play.
Sure, I can excuse that loss from the Chargers. It just sucks the way they lost the first 4 games of their season, or 3 out of 4 to start the year, and really put themselves behind the 8-ball. But they've been running red hot for 2 months now, and Keenan Allen's been just reaping the benefits of tons of targets, like you said. Obviously, everybody knows opportunity drives fantasy points, and Keenan Allen's been getting the most as much opportunity as the next best guy out there for this whole season, really. And nobody can guard him 1-on-1. I mean, he's too quick.
Wow.
His change of direction is ridiculous, and he got great spatial awareness, knows where to be. Like, he's just a great relationship with Philip Rivers.
The timing is there, and the way he runs his routes is very like he'll slow play things.
Yeah.
Like no other, and then take off and speed up, and Devontae does the same kind of things like we were talking about. But
oh, and Rivers will stand in the pocket and pat that ball for a minute. He's under in no pressure to throw.
He'll
the ball.
He'll take a sack looking right at Keenan. Doesn't care.
Plus, right. He's got a lot of weird angles that he can deliver the ball into, and so
it's good.
And the only I've somehow ended up with Keenan on like every single dynasty team that I own, just because I always found some kind of possible value in when we drafted him years ago.
Yeah.
And I tried to offload him this past season. Luckily, I didn't sell him short.
You tried to sell him to everybody that would
offer. I tried to buy him from you for a tenth.
I wouldn't give him to him for 110.
A heated debate. I can't do it for 110.
I was trying to get like 1.5 or 6, but I couldn't do that. And so I was like, well, the worst thing would be to trade him to Casey for 110 and him be healthy all year and then Casey just destroy us. And I was like not ready to let that happen.
Sure.
And now that the fact that he's gone through, what is it, 15 games now, 14 games? There's 2 games left in the season.
Right, so 14
of them, and he's super healthy. His arrow's just right back up. Yeah. And I think that he's done enough now that even if he got hurt again,
agreed,
it still wouldn't tank his value down to where it would have if he had not gone through this ridiculous stretch
he's
of 100 yards games and touchdowns.
He's
and,
number 3 in wide receiver points this year.
Yeah.
I mean, and a 40 burger and a 35 and a 26 back to back to back.
And it's been
right.
So consistent.
We'll do that for
and
you.
You were just waiting for it to drop off,
right.
And it just has never dropped off. It's just been so good.
There's the ceiling and the floor.
Yeah.
Man,
yeah,
maybe.
So where are you guys at here? I rounded out my 10. Where are you guys at here?
I went Keenan at 9 and AJ at 10. And there's some – I want to scream Stephon Diggs to as loud as I can. And Tyreek Hill's explosiveness and his you know ability to crush in NFL 2 years in a row comes to life. Landry's consistency.
Oh, you gotta love Tyreek Hill. This is a discussion for another time.
No doubt. Yeah. No, I'm just saying some guys. We're stopping at 10.
Sure.
And I'm gonna concede to the veteran and AJ Green, who is just like what we were talking about with Nuke Hopkins' team. The Texans melted down last year, and he fell down, and he shot right back up this year when he's playing good and he's young, like. The Bungles of 2017 have struck, and they look horrible. They could easily turn that ship around. 3 weeks ago, Joe Mixon was breaking out. He's looking good. Boom, concussion out 2 weeks. Like, they can't even get a little bit of positive momentum around here.
Offensive line is really struggling. The coach is out of here.
The assistants are looking for other jobs at this point because Marvin Lewis is gone, and they all know it. The back half of this season for the Bengals fell apart. The beginning of the season was horrible for them. They had to fire the offensive coordinator, bring in somebody else. A couple games of spark, and then everything's fizzled out again. So, AJ Green, stay in power. Only receiver in the history of the NFL to make Pro Bowl first 8 years of his career or something like that. I'm going to just ride it with AJ Green. He's silky smooth.
So good.
He's not limping around every play like Julio, and I think that, you know, he's going to be good. If he wants to play in the league 3 or 4 more years, I'll take that.
It's really splitting hairs with, you know, a lot
of
these guys.
That's what I was getting
here.
At. I mean, we're stopping at 10 here. I need to name somebody to be at 10, but we could have a good argument, the same good argument we just had 6 through 10. 11 through 15 is going to be just as great.
Tyreek Hill belongs in the top 15, man.
He does.
He's so
Tyreek
good.
Hill does.
Thielen, maybe?
Jarvis Landry does. Thielen does.
Thielen and Diggs. I don't know if you could put two guys up that high.
Yeah.
But. On the same squad.
Cooks. I would still put Cooks
in
the top 15.
Yeah, I think Cooks is right outside of this 10 for me.
Our next stop-in on this is going to be a good time, too.
And Jarvis Landry.
Right.
That's probably kind of hot.
Yep.
Hopefully you didn't invest in Jarvis Landry the last couple of years and you missed out on all those good PPR points.
Hopefully you deflected that.
It'd be terrible if he had consistent 15 points every week. Like,
you know what would be worse?
You know what
would be worse? If you're like a big name in the industry and a couple months ago you tweeted that you hated Jarvis Landry and you didn't want anything to do with him and then you bragged that you've never invested in him Jarvis Landry's like the second, third. He's the fifth best PPR receiver this year.
Yeah.
It'd be really bad if you're...
Well, his touchdowns are unsustainable.
It'd be really bad if
your
name...
He's got a bad yards per target.
If your name was Matt Kelly and you tweeted about not liking Jarvis Landry in a braggish
form. Oh, he loves it, though. He's sticking by it and good for him.
Yeah.
He plays his role. He knows exactly what he's doing, man.
Yeah.
Hats off to this guy.
Good
he's a great podcaster. His vocabulary is out of this world and
spot on.
It's semi-practice, but whatever.
He knows exactly what he's doing.
He definitely has
though.
A dictionary sitting right next to him.
He knows exactly what he's doing.
A thesaurus.
He's looking for clicks.
Wherever anybody's going, he's going the opposite way because that's what gets clicks. Somebody's got to be the villain.
He's a great click getter.
And
we're about to put out a little YouTube clip just about Matt Kelly.
I'd
probably do pretty good.
The amount that his name comes out of our mouths just tells you who he is.
Right, exactly.
Exactly.
You're welcome.
So, it's respect.
It really is. I mean, I'd love to talk to him face to face. I'd love to get on his podcast and go round and round with him. I got no problem with that. But
people don't. I don't know. We're not getting many invites because we're not bringing anyone on. We're kind of like we do our own thing. Like we have a tough time with just the three of us or two of us just to get through a show. Much less bringing in someone we don't even know what they're thinking
and
how
to
structure that.
I really don't care what you think. I think that's my biggest problem. Yeah. I just don't care what any of you guys think.
Yeah.
I want to
have
my own discussion with my guys.
Right.
And I want to put it out there.
Right.
I'll read your stupid tweets later.
All right. So back to AJ Green. I want to ask a question. Does the Calvin Johnson, I'm 30 years old and I'm about, I feel like stepping away from the game before it's too late and physically, does that loom at all when this Julio and AJ Green are getting on that 30-year-old thresh mark?
Well,
or is the Larry Fitzgerald factor still, like, which one's stronger in your mind? I think it's Larry Fitzgerald is stronger factor in my mind.
I said it earlier, AJ Green, silky smooth. Like, Calvin shouldn't have happened. Dude was like 6'5", ran like a gazelle. You know,
6'5", 235, ran a 4.35.
That's what
it's
I'm
ridiculous.
Saying. Calvin wasn't real. Like you know, he
Megatron
called
was
him
the perfect nickname for him.
Exactly, called him after, nicknamed him a superhero for a reason. Like I just, you know,
and let's just not get it twisted. Like Calvin still would play now if he was on the Eagles or somewhere else.
Lines.
Like if he wasn't from the bottom,
looking
up every year, year after year, putting his body on the line for basically not much. You know, Julio Jones was just in the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
Like I'm not, they're not that, and they're good again. Like a lot of teams don't bounce back the way they just did after a Super Bowl loss. They're right back to where they need to be. It's stupid that the red zone targets and all that stuff isn't up to par. But again, we discussed all that. The coordinator is first year in the league and blah, 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 blah. AJ Green is on the Bengals. Like, and they're about to have a big changing of the guard. You know what? Maybe if things don't go his way and maybe the Bengals stay at the bottom of that division looking up, maybe you could see a little bit of an early retirement or trying to get out of Cincinnati for AJ Green.
A contract restructuring and a sign and trade or get me out of here or release me, coach, or something like that. I could see that. But like Calvin was tired of them saying, we're going to have a running game this year. I've been calling BS on that for 3 years in a row.
Yeah.
They keep saying the Lions are going to have a running game. It never happened. Calvin never had any help. He was so big that body's kind of tore down. AJ Green's a slimmer cat. He's not 6'5", 245. He plays smoother than a big, huge man like that. That should have been a tight end or a linebacker.
Yeah. All right. I'm with you. I think I can round out this with Keenan at 9 and AJ at 10. We all on that same page there?
I'm for sure there. I mean, that's
all right
cool with me.
Well, should we get out of here? That's like a wrap.
I think
that's
a wrap.